worship God. Glad you made it into the house of God this morning. Well, let's lift our voices. Let's sing.
This is a house of worship. This is a place of praise where every demon trembles, where we proclaim your name. This is a house of healing. Our hearts are full of faith.
This is a house of miracles. Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Zach Moore, and I serve on staff on our worship team. I am so glad that you joined us today, and this is my beautiful wife, Rachel. Hey, we would love to know where you're watching from today, so let us know in the chat or the comments. And if this is your first time with us, I'm so glad you chose to come to church at Harvest today. No matter where you're watching, we're so grateful that you came.
Absolutely, and whether you're new or you come every week, now's the time we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page, on the Harvest website, through a link in the comments on YouTube and Facebook, or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love, I know, so many options. We would love to know that you're here and how we can be praying for you this week.
That's right. Hey, we want to help you worship the Lord through giving. And Matthew 6:21 says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." We want to remind you of the ways that you can give. You can give online on this page. You can also hold the camera on your phone up to the QR code on this screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest website. You can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through a text, or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus.
Again, so many options. Today, Dr. Michael Rydelnik continues our teaching series through the book of Ephesians, and it's called Living in Light of Our Eternal Portfolio. You can find your Bible now and be ready to look at the next portion of chapter 1 together.
That's right. Hey, and today in our service, we will remember Christ as we take communion. So find some juice and a cracker or a small piece of bread and be ready to observe this ordinance of the church together later in our service.
Absolutely. And this next one I'm excited about. Families, join us next Saturday, March 27th, 10 a.m. to noon for our first ever celebration of the greatest event in the history of the world.
Wow.
And it's only for kids grade 5 and younger. You can register today for this outdoor event. It includes animals, stories, Easter eggs, treats, games, and crafts, and it's all free. So invite your friends and neighbors who don't know Jesus yet. Because of Easter, we get to celebrate 2 birthdays. This is a free event and space is limited, so you can sign up today at harvestnow.info.
That's right. And wow, that just sounds super fun.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, I want to invite you to be a part of 2 special events right before Easter. First, you're invited to a Seder ceremonial dinner led by Dr. Michael Rydelnik. It's in person on Sunday, March 28th from 5:30 to 7 o'clock p.m. in the Worship Center on the Rolling Meadows campus. It will also be available for online participation for Chicagoland participants who can pick up a box of Seder elements at a Harvest campus on Sunday morning, March 28th. This event is going to be so meaningful and special, but it is almost sold out. And you can get more details and your tickets at harvestnow.info. And then secondly, I really hope you'll attend one of our Good Friday services on Friday, April the 2nd. These services will take place in person on all 6 of our campuses and online. Our Good Friday services are at 4 o'clock p.m. at Rolling Meadows, Elgin, and online at 6 o'clock p.m. at all of our other campuses and online. This is a ticketed event and seating is limited on each campus. Harvest Kids is also available at some locations. So get all the rest of those details and your tickets at harvestnow.info.
Yeah, I'm excited about that, but I'm more excited what comes 2 days later. So in just 2 weeks, we'll get to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ in person on all of our campuses and here online Sunday, April 4th. There's really nothing quite like Easter at Harvest. It's always a big party.
That's
honestly.
Right. That's amazing.
And we want to invite you to join us. Pastor Tommy Kreitz will be preaching and sharing the good news of the gospel. We have digital invites that you can use to invite your friends who need to hear the hope of Jesus. So you can get all service times, locations, Harvest Kids info, and more at harvestnow.info.
That's right. I love it. Hey, as we go to the Lord in prayer now, I want to invite you to pray with me for people who will come to church on Easter, hear the gospel, and commit their lives to Jesus. So let's do that now. Father, we love you so much, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to gather together, Lord. God, we're just lifting up the people that are going to be coming to our services on Good Friday and Easter. And Lord, we're just asking that you would show yourselves to them. We know you can do this, God. We're praying for that. We love you so much, Lord. In your name we pray.
To come,
open the gate, church.
Open the gates and let. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
All my life you have been faithful.
Yes, you have, Lord.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as my friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
In this morning, you received a communion cup. Why don't you pick that up and begin to open it? I want to read to you from the book that we are studying right now, the book of Ephesians. When we sing and when we remember the goodness of God, it's not like remembering a good meal or a good movie or a good day at the beach. It is the goodness of God. And there is no better words to be spoken over us in remembering the goodness of God than the Word of God. Ephesians chapter 1 at verse 7. It says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things, according to the counsel of his will, so that we who are the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. And then let me just read this from chapter 2. And you who were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not of your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. We remember his goodness by the way that he gave us a way to remember him. Let us eat the bread together. And his blood shed for us upon the cross, we remember him and his goodness. Let's drink. God is a good God. I'm going to teach you a new song. About his goodness. How good is he? Far beyond what eyes could ever see. Yet he stands in front of me. How good is he? Who paints a canvas with a million stars. Yet still he holds my heart. Our Father in heaven.
Our Father in heaven, the light of salvation.
How good is he? Forgiveness chance, how could it seem? And the sinner's heart is all I have to blame. Yet still he welcomes me. How good is he?
Lift it up, our Father.
Our Father in heaven, the light of salvation. Oh, how good is he? The breath of my before and behind. Oh, how good is he? Our Father in heaven, our Father in heaven, the light of salvation. Oh, how good is he? The breath of my before behind. Oh, how good is he? How good is he? How good is our God? Can we say he gave us everything? We thank you, Jesus, everything, with everything, for everything. Thank you, Jesus, everything.
Yeah. Come on, so easy.
With everything.
Sing with me.
How good is he? If he never did another thing for me, he is all.
That's right.
Let me ask you, Harvest, are you thankful for the goodness of God?
Yes, I am.
There's a word in Psalm 66. Which in translation is praise like the sound of water falling. I want to invite you to praise God with that word this morning. Come on, let's lift up praise to him like the sound of a waterfall for his goodness. Don't thank anybody else, but give thanks to him. Come on, church. Come on, let the waterfall flow. Such a time as this. On the 21st of March this morning, we're pouring out our praise to him. Come on.
Everything with him.
the breath of all mine, before, behind. Oh, how good is He? How good is He?
Oh, how good is He? Holy, 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 we sing.
Holy, holy,
come on.
Lord Almighty God, glory there's none like You. Holy, holy, Lord Almighty God, glory there's none like You.
Sing holy. None like You in all the world. None like You who's worthy of these words and these songs and our time and our affection and our attention. None like You. Thank You for receiving it, Spirit and truth. In the name of Your Son, who we lift up with songs of praise, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Come on, lift up praise to Him this morning. Amen. Amen. Let's take a seat as we continue.
Morning. Don't applaud till you see later, you know. Just never know. Hey, it's great to see you. Great to be back with you. Greetings to the whole campus, all the campuses. I'm so glad that we can be together and take a look at Your word. I'm looking at the screen here. I put on my shirt this morning without thinking about being on a screen. I hope it's not making you dizzy. I'll remember to wear solid shirts from now on. I'm so sorry. Hey, I saw that there was an announcement about the Seder, the Passover Seder, the Messianic Passover Seder. And I hope that many of you are thinking about joining us. It's going to be great fun, and I think you'll really, really benefit from it. It's a great celebration of redemption. So don't miss that out. Miss out on that. I'm really anxious. I hope you've been reading Ephesians this week. Have you? How many read the whole thing this week? Let me see. I'm looking in the screen, too, in Elgin, at the cathedral, Deerfield. So you've been reading it. That's good. How many read Acts 18 through 20 for special bonus points? You still can do it. It's okay. You know, a lot of people don't have retirement accounts. They don't have 401ks. I recognize that. But for those who do, the monthly income reports are pretty serious, you know? How am I doing? And our lives kind of go up and down based on how those monthly income reports are. I had a friend, a woman that I taught with for many years. And she was so determined. She kept looking at us, oh, it's doing great, it's doing great. I'm going to retire next year. I'm going to retire. And then the Great Recession hit in 2008. She had to teach something like 7 more years before she could retire. And that's one of the problems of looking at an earthly portfolio. So much money can be lost, it can just evaporate like that. And so this morning I want to talk about the good news that we have about our eternal portfolio. It will never evaporate. It will never be subject to decline. The markets don't affect it. And the reason is we have the best portfolio manager that there is, God himself. And so what we're going to do today is start to look at and praise our portfolio manager as we praise him for the portfolio that he gives to us. We'll celebrate what he has done for us. It will cause us, as we look at the portfolio, the eternal portfolio we have, to praise God. I'd like you to get out your Bible. I got a correction this week because I said I prefer paper and ink. I think it's better to read the Bible with paper and ink. How many of you brought an actual Bible? Here you go. Someone rebuked me, said, hey, get into the 21st century, buddy. So whatever Bible you have, whether it's paper and ink, bind-bound, or on your phone, I don't care. Just let's get it out. Let's take a look at Ephesians 1, 3 through 6. Let me just set up where we're at with understanding the book of Ephesians, and then we'll read those verses. So while you're getting out your Bible to Ephesians 1, Ephesians breaks down pretty easily. First three chapters deal with our wealth. The next two chapters and into the beginning of chapter 6 deals with our walk and then finally our warfare. Some people break it down. First three chapters are riches, and the next three chapters are responsibilities. That's a good way of looking at it, don't you think? So we're in the first part of our riches. We're talking in chapter 1 about the riches of redemption. It's really interesting because in chapter 1 you have a section on praise for God, and then there's a section about prayer to God. And we're going to, in the next 2 weeks, look at the praise section. And the way chapter 1, 3 through 6 is, you have verse 3, which is actually a declaration of praise to the triune God. And then verse 4 through 14, which is the details of praise. And it starts with praise for the Father, then praise for the Son, and then praise for the Holy Spirit. So you get the triune God in verse 3, and then the details of the triune God in the rest of that declaration, the details of praise. So that's sort of it's, but we're just going to look at that declaration of praise in verse 3, and then the praise for the Father in verses 4 through 6. So now that we know what we're looking at, we're going to turn to Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus, the Messiah, who has blessed us in the Messiah with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus the Messiah, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. Here's the, it's really a call to praise, and we're going to look at how we must praise God or why we must praise God. And the first reason we should praise God is we must praise God, the triune God, for all the benefits he has given us. That's what you find in verse 3. We have to praise him. Now, it says he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. That's what I'm calling a benefit. It's a spiritual benefit. The word blessing is sort of, I don't know, bless them, bless this person, and sometimes we lose the sense of it. The blessing is a gift or a benefit from God because of his sovereign grace, his love for us. So that's what we're talking about. All the benefits. We praise the triune God for all his benefits. And this verse is saying our benefits come from God the Father. He says, blessed be the God and Father. Now, when you see the word blessed be the God and Father, someone with my background, I think, gets more what Paul is talking about, because I come from a Jewish background, and from the very earliest age, we learn to say a blessing over everything. We have a blessing for everything. You know, you wake up in the morning, you say a blessing. You eat a piece of bread, you have a blessing. You eat a piece of candy, you have a blessing for that too. And they all start the same way. Baruch Ata Adonai, blessed be God. Blessed be the Lord. The Lord God. And so this is so ingrained in Jewish thinking that Paul just comes along here and he says, blessed be the God and Father. It means that he is worthy of praise. It means praise be the God and Father. And so our benefits actually flow from the God the Father. And then it says, our benefits are provided by the Holy Spirit. It says he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Now, we think every spiritual blessing is sort of something you can't touch. But it means really every blessing of the Holy Spirit. Our benefits are actually provided by the Holy Spirit. That's what it's talking about there. And these benefits are not ethereal. They're real. You know, so often we think a spiritual blessing is something you can't grasp a hold of or really understand what they are. They're real. That's what this is talking about, the real blessings that God has brought to us through the Spirit. It's talking about, when it talks about spiritual, it's not something that you can't touch. It's talking about what the Holy Spirit gives to us. These are the blessings given by the Holy Spirit or mediated by the Holy Spirit, I guess you could say. And these blessings are sufficient for life, all of life, because it says he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Every spiritual blessing. That's just amazing to me. They're not ethereal. They're sufficient for all of life. They're everything we need. Peter writes, he has granted us everything pertaining to life and godliness. Here's what this is saying, that God has, in his mercy, given us unbelievable benefits through the Holy Spirit, and they are amazing. And so often what we do is we pursue blessing upon blessing of blessing, and then we get mad at God. That's actually what I did in high school. There was a guy teaching me. He says, you need more of the Holy Spirit. You need the fullness of the Holy Spirit. And so I was pursuing the fullness of the Holy Spirit. He said, you need to get these gifts. I was pursuing gifts. You need to pursue God in a deeper way. Well, that's true. But he says, and then God will bless you. And I was spending time praying, waiting for things. I was waiting to get zapped by God with all the power of the Holy Spirit. And, you know, I kept not getting it. I began to get a little annoyed at God. Like, why don't you do more for me? You do for others, you don't do for me. And then I realized, and the way I came to this great realization was through reading the Bible. Because in reading the Bible, it says that not only does every believer have the Holy Spirit, this is a really good lesson I learned. It says if we don't know him, we don't have the Spirit of Christ. If we do have him, if we do not have Christ, then we have the Spirit of Christ dwelling in us. And then it says, and it goes on to say that we have the power that raised Jesus from the dead living within us. I'm thinking, I'm looking for more power. I think I got pretty much power in there, you know. I just need to learn how to use it, to take hold of it. But the Holy Spirit's already in me. So here's what we do. We start looking for blessings instead of realizing that God has already blessed us with every blessing through the Holy Spirit. Isn't that cool? It's sufficient for every part of our lives. And these blessings are secured in God's presence. It says they are in the heavenly places or in the heavenly sphere. Some says in the heavens. And we think, well, that's positional truth. It's not real. No, it's real. It's secured in the heavenly places. Every benefit we have God has secured. You say, well, I don't want them in the heavenly places. I want them in my life. Of course they're in my life. But God has secured them. They really do belong to us. He has secured them in his presence. You say, well, are they safe? Well, think about having all your money tucked into your mattress, if you have any money. Is it safer there than in the bank? Well, so you might say yes, but no, it's safer in the bank, all that money. And the same way, all the benefits that God has given us, he has secured in the bank of heaven. That's where they're kept safe. And so our benefits are there. And so we bless God and Father, right? And the Holy Spirit. And then it says our benefits here are only available in the Son. It says in verse 3, in the ESV, it says, who has blessed us in Christ or in the Messiah with every spiritual blessing. But that phrase, in Christ or in the Messiah, is actually at the end of the verse in the original. And it is only in Jesus that we have this. What does it mean to be in Christ, to be in the Messiah, to be in the Son? It's used, this term, in Christ, used 27 times in the book of Ephesians. Over and over, we have everything in Christ. What does it mean? It means that we are united with Christ. It means that we are identified with the Messiah. It means that we are uniquely linked to him. So when God sees us, he sees us only in relationship to our unity with Jesus. That's how he sees us. When he's looking at Michael Rydelnik, I'd be embarrassed to have him look at me, our God and Father. But because I have trusted in Jesus, he sees me united with Jesus. He sees me in Jesus. How much better is that? When God sees us, it means that it designates our position. Wherever Jesus is, that's where we are. It defines our privileges. Whatever privilege he has, like going before the Father, we have, because we are in Jesus. Whatever his possessions are, we receive, because he freely shares all things with us. It determines our practice. Whatever he did, that's what we ought to do. We ought to live as he did. We are in Jesus. Think of it like being in a plane. You're not on the wing. You're not grabbing onto the landing gear. We're in the plane when we fly. Remember what that was like? I don't know if you've flown lately. But we're in the plane. So when the plane takes off, we take off. When the plane lands, we land. While it's flying, we're flying. And that's the key. We are in Jesus. It's like being in that plane. Whatever it is that God sees, he sees us only in Jesus. And so this first verse about praising the triune God, wow. It's we praise the Father because of what the blessings he has given us through the Spirit, only available with the Son, with the Lord Jesus. And then in verses 4-6, he gives some details, the first detail about how we have to praise God the Father. And in particular, we praise God the Father for his plan. We praise God the Father for his plan. I want to really look at these. Verse 4 says that God the Father chose us for his plan, for himself. God the Father chose us for himself. So this is part of God's plan. He chose us. A lot of people really get all nervous and upset about this, but the text says it. I don't know what else we can do with it. It says, he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. So God's choice was made before the foundation of the world. God the Father chose us for himself, and he did this before the foundation of the world. That means before creation, God chose you and me. That's before the first brick was ever laid, he chose us. I don't know why, but that's what he did. And that choice guarantees our perfection. It says in verse 4, he chose us to be holy and blameless before Him. It guarantees our ultimate perfection. He's made us holy. Isn't that cool? He's declared us holy, and He's working in our lives to make us more and more holy in practice because He has declared us holy. And one day, we're going to stand before Him holy and blameless, because when we see Him, we shall be like Him. The Father's choice means that God alone is responsible for our deliverance from sin. God alone is responsible. How much did I contribute to God choosing me? Zero. How much did I contribute for God ever deciding this? Nothing. It is purely His responsibility to deliver me from sin. I was talking with my friend Mike V about this week, because we always talk about what we're thinking about. And he said to me, he's really glad that God chose him before time. And I said, why? And he says, because if He had waited for time to begin and I had been born, He'd have never chosen me. I think he quoted someone with that, but I still think that's a great reminder. He'd have never chosen us if he had waited for Him to see, well, let's see what Rydelnik's like. Definitely not chosen. He is responsible for it all. And not only did He choose us, God the Father predetermined that we would be in His family. It says in verse 5, in love, He predestined us. This was God's decision based on His love in advance, and He marked us out beforehand. That's what predestined means. He marked you and me out beforehand. So He predetermined that we would be in His family. What did He mark us out for? The text says, for our adoption as sons, and for all you women and daughters, just so you know, He adopted us into His family. He predetermined that I would be in His family, that my wife would be in His family. He made that completely His decision. He predetermined it. We're in His family. Now, you might say, well, it's only adoption. My sister adopted a baby. He was a crack baby. He was 3 days old when she got him. And now he's 22. Not for one second was he not her son after that. Fully, fully her child to this day. And it's just a wonderful love relationship that they have. God adopted us into His family. We are His children. That was the predecision that He made, the predetermination. This is what one commentator said. I want you to hear this. The believer is not a follower of a new system or religion, nor a worshiper of a vague and distant deity, nor the subject of a capricious tyrant. The believer is a member of the family. That's what we are. We're part of God's family. And this is all because of God's undeserved kindness to us. That was Merrill Tenney who said that. Now, I'm going to give you the next part here in verse 6, that God graciously identified us with His beloved Son. In verse 6, I want you to see this. This is really good. To the praise of His glorious grace. That phrase, to the praise of His glorious grace, it ends each little subsection here in 1:4 through 14. When he says we need to praise the Father, it says that we praise the Father to the praise of His glorious grace. And then when he talks about praising the Son in verses 7 through 12, to the praise of His glory. And then verses 13 and 14 about the Holy Spirit, to the praise of His glory. It's sort of the coda to each of these statements. What does that mean? It means that God did all this that we might praise Him forever. God chose us. He predestined us. He adopted us. He made us part of His family that we might be trophies of His grace, His undeserved kindness forever. Trophies of His grace. That's the picture that it has, that God did this so that we would forever testify to His glory, to the praise of his glorious grace. Isn't that something? I'm a big Yankees fan. And I loved Yogi Berra. And I was watching this video about Yogi. He won so many awards. You know, people don't think of Yogi Berra being the just great player that he was, but he had won three MVP awards, all these great awards, Gold Glove awards, all, so much so that when he was getting older and his kids came to his house, the house was filled with so many trophies that they said, "Dad, you have no place to live. There's no room in the house anymore." And he had a big house. So what they did is they started the Yogi Berra Museum in North Jersey. And you can go there, and now Yogi's gone, but that museum stands to the praise of his greatness as a player. All these trophies filled with it. And I thought, that's what God has done with you and me. He's made us the trophies of his grace. And for all eternity, we will be with him to testify of his glory, to say what a great God he is. That's what to the praise of his glorious grace means. We are his eternal trophies of his grace. It says that he did this in verse 6, with which he has blessed us in the beloved. Now that phrase, I wish it didn't say with which he has blessed us, because it literally says with which he favored us, or even better, with which he begraced us. Everything that we have, that we are trophies of his grace, he has begraced it to us in the beloved. He's given us what we don't deserve and made us into trophies of his grace in the beloved. Now, what's that in the beloved? Are we just beloved by God? No. Do you remember the baptism of Jesus? What did the Father say? "This is my beloved Son." All this grace that we have is because we are in the beloved. It's another way of saying in Christ, in the Messiah. God showered this gift, this undeserved gift on us to be trophies of his grace because we are in the beloved. So I just wanted to get here really quick. Here's what this has been saying, that God made us, God begraced us. He showered his benefits upon us, his eternal heavenly benefits upon us, so that we would praise him forever. That's what this passage is saying. God shows us before time that we would praise him for all time. So I'm going to spend a little more time on our now what. I want to give you two takeaways for today. One is going to take a little bit longer than usual, so I'm sorry. If you thought you're getting out early, sorry. Okay. First takeaway I want us to remember is we need to be specific in praising and glorifying God for all his benefits, for all his undeserved benefits that he gives us. We need to be specific. And so here's what I want to suggest that we do to be specific. Make a list of 14 benefits that we have in the beloved. 14 benefits. You say, 14? That's a lot. I have a reason for saying 14. Okay? And I'll help you. I'll get started with you. This passage tells us that we have the benefit of being in Christ. Right? That's one. That God has chosen us before time. That's a pretty big benefit, don't you think? That he predetermined that we would be believers. That's a big benefit. That he has graced us with the Holy Spirit to give us these blessings. That's a big benefit. You read these verses, let's start listening. In fact, go all the way down to verse 14. Look at all the benefits that our God and Father has given us. He's redeemed us, that's another one, from all our sins. And listen, sometimes we think, oh, I wasn't that bad. Yes, we were. Yes, we were. And make that list. I want you to get to 14. And then for the next week, I want you to start your quiet time by thanking God for the first two, and then the second day, the second two. This is what I want us all to do. we need to get in the place, and by the way, I think having a daily time with God, really, really important. I can't even stress that enough. But too often we start when we pray with, and God, I need this, and I need that. And sometimes we forget about the eternal benefits he's given us. And this says, blessed be the God and Father. Praise be to our God and Father who has blessed us with every blessing. Let's do that. Let's praise him for those blessings. Don't you think? So it's going to be 14 of them. And I've given you a bunch already. You think you can find some more? That's your job. And we're going to list those and spend time every day for the next week till we meet again next week. You're going to spend some time praising God for two benefits a day. If you can't do it, do seven, okay? And just, but I think you're able to. I have a lot of confidence in you guys, okay? That's what we're all going to do. I'm going to do it too, okay? So that's what we're going to do for the next week. The second takeaway, do I have a clock here? Oh, there it is. Okay. Okay, I got it now. Okay. I thought if I'm done now, I'm in trouble. Because here's what I wanted to say. The second takeaway is we need to celebrate rather than criticize God's choice. We need to celebrate rather than criticize God's choice. And here's what I mean by that. When I teach about God's choice of us before time, before the foundation of the world, I get believers griping about that. People complain about that. And there are four major objections that I get, and people call me on the radio to object, or in class they object. It is just, it's like they're criticizing God for his plan, when this passage says we're supposed to praise God for his plan. So let's stop criticizing and start celebrating God for this great plan. So let's go over these four objections. The first objection, people say, it's not fair for God to choose some rather than others. This passage makes it clear. God chose us who are in the beloved to be saved, right? To be forgiven, to be his eternal children, to be trophies of his grace. It's not fair that he chose some of us rather than others. And the answer to this is, it's God's right as the sovereign of the universe to choose as he wills. It's God's sovereign right. He is the king. It's what Paul talks about in Romans 9, that he is the potter. We're the clay. He gets to do with the clay whatever he wishes. That is his sovereign right. And I think we shouldn't complain that God is exercising his right. Now, we live with God's sovereign choices every day. You say, no, I don't. Yes, we do. Some of us are tall. Some of us, not so much. Some of us have hair. Some of us don't. Some of us have really good health. Some of us struggle with our health. God makes sovereign choices. I fully believed when I was a kid that I was going to play in the NBA. I was pretty good at basketball. And when I was 14, I was already 5'8". I had four more years of growth. I was going to be like 6'3", I was sure. My band teacher in school made me a bass player because he said, look at those hands. You're going to be huge. And I was 11 years old. And then I was 14, never grew another inch. In fact, now it's reversing. Why is that? God's sovereign choice. We live with God's sovereign choices all the time. And God is fair. Here's what I think is fair. Everyone chooses to be separated from God. Everyone walks away from God. There's none that seek him, it says, right? And then God, in his mercy, chooses some. But God is totally fair. If he were really super fair, he wouldn't even choose any of us in mercy. But he chooses some in his mercy. I have a friend I went to seminary with, and he was really obsessed with getting an A in every course. So we were taking a pretty technical course in New Testament introduction. At the end of the course, he had a B+. And it was very important for him to have an A in every course. And both he and I had gotten three wrong on the final. If he had gotten just one more answer right on the final, he would have had an A-. I mean, it was just a slight percentage point that would have lifted him up. So he went to the professor, and he said, got out all his pre-computer, so he got out all his calculations and showed him how it would raise him up 0.1% for the whole course, and that would put him over into an A-. And the professor says, okay, I'll show you mercy. I'll give you the A-. Now, I already had an A-, but if I had gotten one more question right, I would have gotten an A. My friend comes to me, he says, Michael, go see Dr. Honer. He'll do this for you. And so, I said, okay. I went to Dr. Honer, got out my calculation, showed him just one more question. He said, I think A-minus is a good grade. But, he says, if I choose to show mercy to your friend, am I not being just with you by giving you the grade you deserve? This guy was my thesis advisor. Yes, sir, absolutely. When God shows his mercy by choosing some, doesn't mean he's being unfair to others. They are getting what they chose. So, people say it's not fair for God to choose some rather than others. Absolutely fair for God. Secondly, some say it's not logical for God to choose some and then still hold people responsible. It's just not logical. How can we have human responsibility when God is sovereign? When God chooses, this doesn't make any sense to me. I want to confess something to you. Doesn't make any sense to me either. The answer is, this is one of many mysterious antinomies. An antinomy is an apparent contradiction that's really not a contradiction. This is one of many mysterious antinomies that we just have to accept. We must accept God is sovereign and we are responsible. We just have to accept it. The scriptures teach both. Some verses right next to each other. Have you ever noticed that? It says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Sounds like human responsibility. We grow out of our salvation, right? But then it says, but God is the one who's at work in you, both to will and to do it. Well, that sounds like God's sovereignty. Which is it? The answer is yes. They're both true. Never forget that they're both true. A physicist in the end of the 19th century, Thomas Young, determined that light was a wave. In 1905, Albert Einstein determined that it was a particle. Later, physicists have argued about this, but by the end of the 20th century, they declared the dispute a draw. Because as much as it's not possible, light is a particle and a wave. It's both. And scientists say, well, we just have to live with this mystery. Well, if scientists can live with that mystery, can't we live with the mystery that God is sovereign in his choice, and yet we are responsible? I think this is really important to accept it. Warren Wiersbe once said, when I met him many, many years ago, try to explain God's choice, you may lose your mind. Try to explain it away, you may lose your soul. And so Spurgeon was asked, how does he reconcile sovereignty and choice? Sovereignty and human responsibility? He says, I never try to reconcile them. You don't try to reconcile friends. They're both true. Live with it. Third objection, it's not practical to evangelize if only the chosen will be saved. Why proclaim the gospel? I'm going to give you the answer. We have to obey the Great Commission. The answer is we're still responsible to obey the Great Commission. Spurgeon also said if God had painted a yellow stripe on the backside of every person that was elect, I'd pull up their shirt and I would check out who's elect and only preach to them. But since he didn't do that, I preach to everyone. I make the invitation for everyone. It's obedience to the Great Commission. We have to obey the Great Commission. So when I share my faith, when I present the gospel, I do it like it all depends on me and all depends on the person. But when I pray for someone, I pray like it all depends on God. And you know what? That's how we do. That's how we present the gospel. Here's the last objection. It's not genuine to invite a response if only the chosen will accept the invitation. It's not genuine to invite a response if only the chosen will accept the invitation. God says it is genuine. God offers a genuine invitation to all, even though he knows some won't accept. He knows they're not going to accept, but he still invites them. You say, well, how can that be? Listen, I am a college professor. It seems like every other day I'm getting a wedding invitation. And I tell students, they write to me, can I get your address so I can send you a wedding invitation? I said, don't bother, I'm not coming. If I went to every wedding, I'd be going to weddings all the time. And they say, it's okay, we still want to invite you. Why? Because they want to say, we love you, Dr. Rydelnik, and we want you to come, even if you can't. And they give me a genuine invitation, even though they know I'm not coming. God gives everyone a genuine invitation, even those he knows won't respond. That's what's crucial to remember. Well, I really wanted to emphasize how important it is for us to recognize God's choice. That's what Ephesians 1, 3 through 6 is really about, that God chose us, he predestined us, he adopted us into his family all before time. That's pretty cool, I think. Let you know about how this works. Before a stone was laid in St. Paul's Cathedral, the entire glorious building was already seen in the mind of Sir Christopher Wren. He already saw that whole building. And before a chip was taken off the distorted marble slab, Michelangelo already saw the David statue in its complete entirety. He knew it. Before Leonardo da Vinci painted one drop of paint of the Mona Lisa, he had that image in his mind. He knew exactly what it was going to be. It was already there. And before one stone was laid in this creation, before it ever happened, God already saw you and me as eternal trophies of his grace. He knew it. He saw it. He made it happen. That's the greatness of our God. Here's the point of Ephesians 1, 3 through 6. Never forget this. God the Father planned our salvation before time so that we would give him praise for all time. That's the point. Let's pray. God our Father, thank you for being so unbelievably gracious to us, that you would provide redemption for us with your Son and secure it by your Spirit. God, we're so grateful. We want to give you praise this morning and every day for your good plan that we don't deserve. You deserve it all. We give you praise, and we give you this praise in the name of Jesus, our Messiah. Amen.
And let's stand and respond.
I once was lost. I walked away. The road was dark. I could not see. My hope was gone, and the pain was real. But your mercy, you saw my steps and felt my fears. You heard my cries and caught my tears. Arms open wide, you ran.
A great word from God's word today through Dr. Michael Rydelnik. Oh, and hey, young adults, we're meeting all together this Thursday night, March 25th at 6:30 p.m. at the Elgin campus. Now, we usually meet at the Rolling Meadows, so we're changing up this time. So we hope you can join us.
Yes, please join us. And I also want to remind everyone that you can get all details about Easter, Good Friday, the Seder dinner, which is almost sold out, and the Harvest Kids Easter birthday party at harvestnow.info. And we also want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 and 11 Central Time. If you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, we would love to see you in person at one of our campuses.
That's right.
You are loved.